covenant for marriage boundaries, that we could spend all night on, right? Honor for physical property. Why would God say he cares about physical property? I mean, it's just stuff, right? We can never forget that we represent God to our fellow human beings, represent him well. So we go on, honor for moral integrity. The highest honor we show to others is to reveal purity in thought, intents, and deeds. Now I missed one, didn't I? Which one did I miss? The fourth commandment. Let's go back to this. I skipped this because I wanted you to see something, and I wish I had a little bit more time, but there's something, there's a device, a grammatical device. It's called an antonetta. But I cannot say that word. Okay. I can't say it. Okay. I'll come back to that word. But anyway, the word means, this is weird. Okay. But it means that if you say 1, 2, 3, then the device says you have to say 3, 2, 1. So if you say A, B, C, you would say C, B, A. Okay. I can spell it, but I can't say it tonight. I don't know what's wrong. But here, look at this. Moral loyalty to God, mental loyalty to God, physical loyalty to God, then the Sabbath honors my relationship to my Creator. Now here's the device that God used. He goes backwards. Moral integrity, mental integrity, physical integrity, then honor. In the middle is where we live in our human relationship. Now, why is this important? Because the Sabbath represents a wedding band to God. It's a sign, Ezekiel says, between me and my God that means to him that I belong to him and he belongs to me. When you got married, when so many people get married, what do you do when you get married? Slip on that band. Look at the band. Here's the band for God. Here's the band for man. At each place, after we have this commitment of moral, mental, and physical integrity, we have to seal it with a promise. When God shows us he wants moral, mental, and loyal integrity, we seal it with our pledge of honor and obedience and faithfulness that God, we promise we will never disavow what he asked us to remember. We have to rise above our own thinking, our own traditions, our own feelings about how we serve God and recognize he is the creator, I am the servant. If there's ever any difference in that relationship, then you should just, God says, I'd rather you be hot or cold. Because I don't want that. Then, and I'm wrapping up. In fact, I don't know if I have time to go over that. This is how we want to bring this to a head. Thorough transformation happens how? From the inside out. Most people try to make their changes from the outside in. That's backwards. If I want to change my weight or my appearance, or I need to recognize what is going on inside me first and why I'm the way I am, why I feel the way I do, and then work to make that manifest itself on the outside. Transformation happens from the inside out, but the power only comes from the outside. It is one of the greatest lies in natural therapies. You heal from within. You have the power to heal yourself. The human body can heal itself. That's the biggest lie ever told. Listen, think about it. If you could heal yourself, would you be sick now? I mean, if you can heal yourself, would you need to go to the doctor? Would free health care in Canada mean anything? Oh. The second biggest lie is that medicine will heal you. You can try as much as you want. You can take as much medicine as you want. Medicine can't heal you. The third biggest lie, hold your breath, that herbs and stuff can heal you. That's the third biggest lie ever told. And I deal with herbs all the time, only because God says so. You see, I'm not doing it because the herbs can heal. I'm doing it because he told me to do it. And he said, Rick, I am the Lord thy God that heals you. I am the Lord thy God that heals you. How in the world could a doctor take the place of God if you didn't give it to him? How in the world could medicine take the place of God if you didn't give him that power? God says in Ezekiel 47, verse 12, he said, the leaves of the trees shall be for meat. In other words, he's telling me how to eat. And he says, the fruit of the tree shall be for meat. And the leaves shall be for medicine. In Ezekiel it says for medicine. In Revelation it says for the healing of the nations. I'm only doing that because God told me to do that. You need more? Exodus 15, 26, read 22 to 26. He said they needed water. The water was bitter. They cried out to Moses. Notice how when religious people get excited, they look to some man. They want a preacher. They want this. They want to follow. Moses had sense. He cried out to God. He said, God, the water is not drinkable. What should we do? He said, Moses, you see that tree over there? That tree over there? Go and get that tree. When you chop it, wait a minute. That's work, isn't it? You mean God couldn't just wave his hands and speak the word and the water be healed? He said, no, go cut down that tree and bring it over to the water. When you put it in the water shall be made sweet. Wait, he didn't stop there. You read down to verse 26. He said, then he made that a statute. Wait a minute. What does that mean? He made it a statute for them. That means the next time you see this water bitter like that, do the same thing. Find that same tree. God is instructing me how to deal with my life and my life circumstances and my health, not some man. I mean, but then he went on. If you read the rest of the verse, it says, and thereby he proved them. What does that mean? He tested them to see if they would faithfully do what he asked them to do. Has God proven your life? Have you passed the test? Can he look at your life and say, this is my servant. They will do what I ask them to do and how I ask them to do it and when I ask them to do it. If I say serve me at this time, they will serve me at this time. If I say serve me this way, then they will serve me this way. That's what it means to love God. That's what it means to love God. If we would really internalize this, we would weep tonight because we are not loving God the way He demands and respects. This is what love demands. Unflinching loyalty to love Him and what He says, even unto death. You have to measure yourself by the ruler that God gives. And if you don't love God that way, that's okay. But as long as you come to Him so that He can fix your heart. It's just a heart problem. He's not going to reject you because you have a heart problem. He won't turn you away because you have a heart problem. See, some of us have a weak heart, some of us have a heart murmur, and some of us are nigh to death. They got to bring out the paddles, God said, to rescue my life. But it doesn't matter if you are at paddle death or if you're at a heart murmur. Come to God. He is the one who can fix your love so that you love Him this way. The last thing I want to show, and that's what I was saying, I don't have any power to fix myself. You got to acknowledge that. Before you go to God in prayer in the morning, just acknowledge to yourself that you don't have anything. Three dimensions of man, a complete commitment. Seven areas of authority, a complete surrender equals to 10 commandments, a whole life. That's it. That's the pattern for living. When every area, see, we have done people a disservice when we say, I even hear a lot of, okay. When we tell people it doesn't matter what you eat or drink, as long as you love Jesus. Complete commitment, complete surrender. If you didn't give life to that person, you have no right to try to tell them how to live if God didn't say it. You have no right. In fact, you are blaspheming. You are putting yourself in God's stead. Keep your mouth quiet if you don't know what to say. And by all means, when you're bragging about your accomplishments and what you don't do and how you don't do it, God is offended by that because you're telling Him all He had to do was teach you how not to eat meat or how not to eat pork or how to do something, and He could have kept Jesus on the throne. Instead of sending Him down here to die, He could have just done that and you would have been okay and everybody would have been okay. I just really wanted to show you this, and I'm not going to even go to it. It's just showing you this again. No other God is a supreme authority. No other God can see. No other God obey. Then the life sign of covenant loyalty is honoring God the way He says to honor Him. If God tells you to remember something, how can you forget what He told you to remember? That's a sign of covenant. Parental honor is the first sphere of human relations. God says respect that. Then He says, have honor for everybody's life equal to yours. No murder. then the life sign of covenant loyalty in a human sphere is the marriage relationship. He says you should not disrespect that relationship in any manner. Then he says, honor the boundaries of each other's physical property. Honor the boundaries of intellectual integrity. Honor the boundaries of moral integrity. That's what love demands. That's what love demands. And I'm going to tell you something. The reason I had a very difficult time just teaching this as an educational exercise is because this hits me and it reminds me how much I need God. It reminds me that there's nothing about me that is good enough to impress God in the least bit. And the only hope I have of being rescued from this world is total surrender. I got to give up because I don't love like that a lot of times. The thing that allows me to stand here with a clear conscience is that he said, whosoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. I can come. You can come. Flaws and all, warts and all, caught in the very act. Come. Just stand with me if you want God to do this operation. If you recognize that there's areas in your life that you know that God needs to heal, stand with me so I can pray for us both. Father, as we stand before you today, we recognize this is a solemn time in Earth's history because we do not have the power to live through these terrible days if you don't give us that power. We have no power. We need something that is beyond ourselves to empower us, and we don't have it. So I'm asking you today, first, for those who have never accepted Christ, give them a taste of the water of life tonight, today. May their thirst be so high that they will not sleep well. They will not rest until they turn their permission slip into you to do the heart surgery. Then there are many who have been following and pursuing you years, but yet there are dark corners in our lives where we need to surrender. You said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. It's the heart throne that you're knocking at for entrance, and only we hold the key. Father, help us to yield those dark corners of our lives. And then, Father, there are some of us who have been pursuing you, and yet we are blind in many respects to who and what we are. We need eyesight. We need eyesight. We are blind. We want to see. And just like blind Bartimaeus, who screamed out, "Son of David, don't pass me by." We're saying that tonight. Do not pass us by. And you ask the simple question, what do you want? That I may receive my sight. That's what I need. To receive my sight so that I can follow you more perfectly. Those that are praying for that tonight, Father, answer their prayers. Grant them their desires. Jesus died for them. He died for me. And the Holy Spirit is just waiting to do this surgery and give us power so that we can do what love demands. It's my prayer in Jesus' name, for his sake I pray. Amen. Amen.